On today's show.
Yet another Thunder-Spurs playoff game ends in no-call controversy, but is that the real reason San Antonio is down 3-2?
In Crossfire, did Dwight's TNT appearance make him more likable? And what should ATL do with Big AL?
And we debate which team takes control in the series no one likes to watch.
It's Wednesday, May 11th. The Starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or joining us live on NBA TV or a little bit later on YouTube, we're happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
Hopefully you still like to watch us.
To his right, it's the international man of mystery, taking it to the max. That's Lee Ellis.
Friend. Lily.
Lily, and last, certainly not least, over there in a cool shirt, Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
TK, what do you got for us?
Guys, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag the starters. And earlier today, the league announced that Scott Foster would be reffing Game 5 of Raps Heat up in Toronto. And that's great news, because the last time we saw him, Scotty Too Hottie was earned the title of best referee in the NBA from Tass for his emphatic ejection of Sean Livingston during Game 4 of the Warriors series. Get out of here. People went crazy for Foster's toss, so we thought we'd put our own skills to the test. When earlier today we headed out to the cage to try our hand at some Foster-inspired ejections in our very first ejection competition. The first contestant was J.E. Skeets, who went with something he called the axle toss, inspired by figure skating. Just peep this elevation and torque. Innovative move, Skeets. What were you thinking here?
We got a replay on this.
Oh, yeah.
Get him out of here. Up next was Tass, who went baseball with a move he called You're Going Home, making like a third base coach. Tass, I literally thought your arm was going to fly off.
Super this, fast.
Oh, I'm still feeling it, man. I'm still feeling it.
As he is wont to do, Lee went with a nod to the 80s with a move he calls Moonwalker. It's one of his two go-to dance moves, but we can't hate because none of us can do the moonwalk. As for your boy, I went to the baseball diamond as well with a move called Hideo Thromo, inspired by the 1995 Rookie of the Year. And if you can't tell, that was a fork ball on that ejection.
Nice.
Full extension. If you didn't love Hideo Nomo in the 90s, what's your problem?
Oh,
but this is where you come in. Oh, if you go over to our Twitter page, at the starters, you can pick the winner for this ejection competition. So hit up at the starters, get your votes in. We'll check the results later, because if something goes down tonight, Scott Foster might need a little inspiration.
Mm. Yeah, all right, so there you go. Yeah, go over to at the starters on Twitter, make your votes. All right, we have a fun show, in case you couldn't tell tonight. We got Crossfire, Tass and I will go head-to-head in that, and we'll get you ready for tonight's two Game 5s. But first, last night in San Antonio, Russell Westbrook, he couldn't be stopped late, even when the Spurs were trying to foul him. Westbrook finished with 35-11-9, helped the Thunder rally in the fourth quarter to beat the Spurs 95-91. They take the 3-2 lead in the Western Conference semifinals. There's a lot to break down from this one. Well, let's start with the obvious question. What do you think the biggest reason is the Thunder, in a bit of a shocker here, are up 3-2 in this series?
I think it's the Thunder defense. They are locked in. That Thunder defense is making the Spurs offense unrecognizable. You look out in that Spurs team when they're in the fourth quarter trying to execute, and they're not. You can't really understand what's going on here, to the point where a Hall of Fame point guard doesn't understand that there's 2 seconds left on the shot clock and he's got to shoot the ball. The Thunder are in the Spurs' head to the point where these guys just don't shoot. This is a minute later in the fourth quarter. These guys aren't shooting. They're afraid to shoot to a degree. They knew in this series Westbrook and Durant were going to go off, that they had to get some points on the other end. We can hold them to about 90, but we're going to have to score, and they just cannot find their flow on that end. Again, to the point where guys are offensive rebounding on them. They're just not mentally there, where they can't find the ability to shoot the basketball. I think that's what Greg Popovich is most angry. Forget about the fouls. He's just most angry at guys not shooting the ball and that they're the team that isn't executing in the fourth quarter. That's the shock here.
And Oklahoma City Thunder did that with Enes Kanter and Deion Waiters on the floor for a lot of that fourth quarter. Two guys who are pillared for their defense throughout the season, especially Enes Kanter. I mean, he gets killed a lot for D, but he's a very good rebounder, and that sometimes is underrated about just how valuable it is for a guy who knows how to get his hands on the ball. Because coaches always talk about a stop isn't over until you get possession of the ball, and that's what Kanter does well. But also, on the offensive end, Russell Westbrook was obviously brilliant.
I was just going to say, Russell Westbrook was unbelievable, especially after a very weird first half where he had those six turnovers, and a lot of them were because, and I know Weber talked about this on the broadcast, it looked like he was almost trying to set up guys a little too much.
Yeah.
And he wasn't playing Westbrook-type basketball, which is usually be aggressive and seek out your shot and, yeah, get guys involved. But once he got going in the second half, I mean, it was lights out. I mean, he had some, like, highlight-like rebounds.
Yeah.
Or then he was going the other way and just attacking, put up great numbers in the second half.
Well, this is when I think Russell Westbrook is at his best, when he plays that way in the first half. When he passes and he just gets locked in mentally, that's when he plays his best defense. That's when he locks down the other, because he just reins it in a little bit. He knows he can score whenever he wants, but I think he runs the game plan and figures things out and makes sure everybody gets theirs, and then he takes over towards the second half. I think that's when he is locked in the most, and he is the best Russell.
Were you surprised that the Thunder actually won this game? Because the Spurs went on many runs. I mean, they were up 13 at one point in this game. They were up 6 points twice in that fourth quarter. It sort of felt, especially being in San Antonio, okay, they might put them to sleep here. This might be it.
Yeah.
And the Thunder come back and win this.
It is rare to see the Thunder as well throughout the course of the season were horrible in fourth quarters. And the fourth quarter, they were much better than San Antonio, who, again, at home, you always expect the Spurs to sort of come out on top because they just always have a different way of beating teams. But Russell Westbrook, again, just getting back to him for a second, Greg Popovich has talked about when he's going at full speed, it's very hard to have a defensive plan for him because he's always moving around and he's scattering the defense. And that just opens things up for Oklahoma City. He hit a lucky three-pointer as well, that long bomb right there.
Sure.
But that's fine because that's what you take with Russ. He's taken that shot whether he's missed his last five or he's hit his last five, and then they know that he's feeling good about himself right now. So it's a very strange series, this one. Like, the Spurs obviously split the first two, then they split the second two as well, and now they're fighting to stay alive in Oklahoma City.
Well, look, just like game two, we had a controversial no call at the end of this one. Now, different situation here, different score, of course, but with less than 10 seconds to go, you know, the Thunder leading by a point, and you see it there. Westbrook got the inbounds pass. He goes towards the basket, and it appears like Kawhi Leonard fouls him, but the refs hold their whistles until Westbrook gets to the rim. Then they call the foul. That's the and-one layup there. Russ knocks down the free throw. Now it's a four-point game, and the Oklahoma City Thunder go on to win that. What did you guys think about that no call, where it definitely looked like, from us at home, that Kawhi was wrapping him up? What else were they going to do?
That was a foul. I don't think that was what sent the Spurs home with the loss, but I think the first one was actually worse. 54 seconds left. This one, yeah, he tries to wrap him up, sure. It doesn't, because Russell Westbrook is so strong, he doesn't change direction at all,
yeah.
So it doesn't look like Kawhi gets him to the naked eye, but LaMarcus also didn't hit him, so that was the shocking part. That being said, they would have been up 2 or 3 points after Westbrook was done with that and still had to hit a shot. This one with 55 seconds left, to me, Durant misses this shot, and only because Steven Adams trips Danny Green does he get the foul. The shot is missed. It's Spurs ball, tied up, 50 seconds. Instead, they're down two after the free throws that Durant shouldn't have gotten. Smart move by Steven Adams. Nobody saw it.
Mm-hmm.
But then they couldn't get the lead back
right
after that. So to me, that was the bigger one. Although Pop, I know, he's telling his guys, hey, you want to win? Shoot the basketball.
The savvy move, I think, by Steven Adams, whether it was deliberate or not. You know, he got his man off course, and then Kevin Durant went and missed a shot, got fouled anyway. But on that first one, I think actually Kawhi Leonard's at fault. He doesn't wrap him up. He goes in there expecting the referee to call a foul just because there's contact. And Westbrook, you know, he doesn't stand there still for anybody. He just takes off.
That said, usually in these situations,
yeah,
the coach, the players, they go up to the refs. They say, look, we're down one.
Yeah.
So we're going to go for a steal. If we don't get it, we're going to wrap him up because we've got to put him to the free throw line.
But that's not
a referee.
I mean,
you can't tell me he doesn't have his arms all
over.
Yeah,
he does, but he doesn't wrap him up. You only think about when guys go inside.
What do you want him to do, tackle him?
Yes, I want him to stop him, to make it so that there's not any debate at all about whether or not he fouled him. When you see guys going fast breaks, and we hate it when guys just go there and slightly tap a guy and he goes and finishes and give him that one, it's exactly the same situation there. Leonard knew he was supposed to foul him. Grab him. Just grab hold of him.
The funny part is they call the foul on LaMarcus, which was,
yeah,
I don't know if he even touched him.
Right.
What's also funny is the Spurs complain a lot about foul calls, and now they're complaining about a foul not being called. I mean, you see it throughout the game. There's a lot of complaining. Both teams do it, and now they're complaining that they didn't get a foul call.
I think Greg was great after the game. Popovich was great after the game saying, hey, we lost the game.
Yeah.
They shot 6 of 21 in the fourth quarter. Parker had many looks to tie the game up or take the lead. He was at the free throw line. He splits them. I mean, they had their chances. Pop knows that exactly. All right, well, the Thunder are up 3-2 in this. So the question is, do you guys think the Spurs can still win this series? They got to go into the Thunderland, win one there, and, of course, take care of things in Game 7 at home. What do you think?
Yeah, they definitely can win. The Clippers did it to them last year, round one. They won Game 6 in San Antonio. They went back home and won Game 7. I think it's up. You mentioned Tony Parker's name. Tony Parker has to be extremely aggressive because he can create his own shot and create for others. I think it starts with him, number one. And those jumpers open up for LaMarcus, and they open up for Kawhi. And maybe LaMarcus is a little bit more comfortable because LaMarcus, 6 of 21, that guy should be able to score at any time, at any point, and Tony should help him. Those guys, those three guys I just mentioned, just have to shoot the ball.
Yeah, well, I mean, you'd never write off San Antonio either. They've won in Oklahoma City already. They know how to play in these big games. And they know if they do win, I think this favor then goes back into their into their advantage because they have game seven at home, which is very tough to see Oklahoma City winning that game. But look, Thunder got a great chance. This is what they needed to do, get to be going home to try to close out the series.
Look, the Spurs, with under the Pop era, only once being down 3-2 in a series have come back to win it. That was 2008 against the New Orleans Hornets. Pop doesn't have a great record in elimination games on the road. I think the Thunder take care of business in game six. I think it was obviously a huge game. That's why we usually call game five pivotal. And the Thunder squeaked it out, mainly on the backs of Russ, KD, and their bigs. We got to take a break, though. Lots more still to come. Crossfire. Dwight Howard gets grilled a little more.
Trey will give Skeets and me three topics. We'll debate each one, and you at home will declare the winner on Twitter. Trey, let's tell them how it works.
Yeah, if you're following along at home on Twitter, you're picking the winner. If you think Tass is winning, blast out a tweet, hashtag Tass wins. If you think Skeets is winning, hashtag Skeets wins. Every tweet counts, so tweet early, tweet often. And here we go with round one. Dwight Howard guested on Inside the NBA last night, and in a surprise to many, the crew went for nearly 15 minutes and even skipped a commercial break as Charles and Kenny grilled Dwight about everything from playing with James Harden to Dwight's own likability. People loved it, so tell me, did Dwight's Inside interview make him more likable? Here we go!
Yes, it did. People have to forgive Dwight. He didn't murder anybody. He had a PR blunder. He had a couple bad years in LA and Houston. That's it. He's had a good career. He's likable. And I've actually thought that Dwight should go to whatever team he wants and help them win a championship. I believe in him. He's one of the best centers in the NBA. People should give him a lot of money. If I was in a front office, I'd say, yes, pay that man. It's all about the floor, and it's about the locker room environment. He's a likable guy.
Two reasons why that didn't change anything for me or make Dwight more likable. One, everything Dwight says, you have to take with a grain of salt. That's just the way it is. People dislike him because he is shown to be fake in the past. That's just the truth.
Right.
And secondly, when they asked him about his future in regards to opting out, he said, you know, he didn't want to answer it, okay?
What else is he supposed to do?
Well, like, do we seriously believe he's going to stay in Houston? Especially within the interview, basically throwing shade at James Harden and saying, I don't get the ball enough. So, like, I don't believe it for a second, so just sort of say that. Why not? So it didn't really change my idea about Dwight Howard.
I thought the S wasn't for Superman. I thought it was for sincere. No. I thought he was quite sincere.
Well, he fooled you.
All right, round two. For the second straight season, the Atlanta Hawks were swept out of the playoffs by LeBron James and the Cavaliers. Ka-ka. And with Al Horford becoming a free agent, there's talk about the Hawks blowing things up. So let's start with the biggest piece. Should the Hawks offer Al Horford a max contract? Here we go.
A max contract? No. No, 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 no. We're talking, what, $150 million likely for a five-year deal. Al Horford, as great a player as he is, he's already 30, or turn 30 next month, I should say. Would you be shocked if he's a bench player in 3 to 4 years in this league? I wouldn't, and I wouldn't want to be paying a bench player that's maybe going to give me like 15-8 type production, $30 million plus. I would not throw the max at Al Horford, no way.
If that's what it takes, I think you'd do it.
Really?
You know why? Because you can still trade him.
They did it with Joe Johnson.
He's a better asset in your house than walking away, just like Damari Carroll did last year. You can move him, and you try him out with Paul Millsap. Maybe you only really have 1-4 on your team. You trade Paul Millsap. Have Al Horford as your 4. Try out Tiago Splitter as your center, who is an NBA champion. Well, you've got time. I just think you let him go, you don't get an asset. Why not bring him in-house? Move them along some point down the road.
They got a whole lot to figure out, the Hawks. I mean, not only Al Horford, Kent Bazemore is probably going to get quite the increase in pay, and what do you do with Jeff Teague and Dennis Schroeder? But I don't throw the max at Al. As much as I love Al and his pretty eyes, I don't throw the max at Al.
He does have gorgeous eyes, and we're coming to round three of a tight one. During game four of Raptors Heat, Brent Berry dropped a couple of tasty puns like Infinity and Biombo after a big Bismack dunk and Powell to the people after Norman Powell threw one down. With Brent on the call in Toronto tonight, what kind of pun should he work into the broadcast? Here we go!
All right, when enemy of Canada, number one enemy of Canada, Dwayne Wade gets blocked, I want Brent Berry to recite and then sing part of the national anthem. All right, so Dwayne Wade gets blocked. This is what Brent Berry has to do. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. He will be loved in Canada for the rest of his life. Never have to buy a drink in Canada. Brent, that's what you got to do.
Okay. Well, I have it on good record that Bones was at a Pearl Jam concert last night in Toronto. He loves Pearl Jam. He's probably going to see him again.
Fact.
Here's some photo evidence. He actually sent me this. So, here's what I want. Stick with Biombo. When Biombo gets in foul trouble, Bones needs to drop a, clearly I remember, picking on Biombo. Seemed a harmless little fowl. Ooh, but we unleash the lion. The first part's really important part. I didn't really figure out the rest of it, but that's what I would do.
A lot of singing.
That's okay.
A lot of
the
singing.
End of round three, and Skeets wins. So that means Tess.
Yeah!
I did not know what was going on there.
Skeets wins.
I got hit with a rosin bag.
We gotta take a break when we come back. We'll get you set for tonight's two game fives in Toronto and Oakland. Don't go anywhere. Back in the starters, inspired by Scott Foster's toss the other night, we tried to come up with some new creative tosses. I had the Axel throws, or whatever it was called.
You're going home!
That's what Tassie is. Lee went with the moonwalk. That's what that was. And Trey, what was yours called?
This is the Hideo Throw-mo.
Yeah, that's right. That's great. So there it is. So you got a few tweets about our ejection competition, Trey.
Yeah, Bick says, that baseball pitch ejection was excellent. Mm. And Juan Carlos says he loves the moonwalker.
Yep.
But the winner, as handed down from on high, is Jay Skeets.
Wow.
With the axle toss. Back-to-back victories for Skeets. First crossfire, now this. Wow, it's a dynasty.
What did the Russians judge on that?
Maybe they just had loaded up that overlay there, the text on the bottom, and they didn't want to change it in the control room.
Is that what happened? I don't know, Tad. I think I won. All right, let's look at tonight's NBA schedule. We got two game fives. Heat and Raptors, Blazers and Warriors. Heat Raps tied at 2 apiece. That gets underway at 8 p.m. Eastern on TNT, and then the Warriors try to put the Blazers to sleep in 5 at 10:30 p.m. Eastern. Guys, Dwayne Wade, about that Heat-Raptors series, he had a great quote today. Quoting Wade, I don't know how much tighter your butt cheeks can get.
So we went out to the cage and we saw how tight they could get.
Yeah, that's right. So a great quote from Wade. He's been on fire, actually, with the quotes the entire series here. But who do you think takes control tonight? It's a huge game, just like it was in the Thunder-Spurs series, game 5 here.
I'd be lying if I told you I knew. No one knows out there. It's been very, very even, and I think what makes it very difficult is we haven't seen either team really play to their capabilities.
Yeah.
So if I'm going to pick one, I'm going to pick the one where Dwayne Wade is playing on, because they're going to be booing him in Canada because of the national anthem exhibit. So I think he'll have that going for them. And plus, the Raps, I just don't trust them at home just because of the stress level that I feel like they've put on themselves and Kyle Lowry and friends to have to a degree. So I'm going to go with the Heat, but if anyone tells you they know, they're lying.
Yeah, I'll just take the Raptors because they are at home, and this is basically a must-win. Their season is on the line. If they lose this, then they have to go to Miami to win Game 6. DeMar DeRozan has to get out there and get to the free throw line. I've been banging on about that all playoffs. He's only gone 10 for 20 over the last 3 games of this series. I know he's got a sore thumb. That's hurting him now.
That is a legitimate injury.
No, I'm not questioning.
He can barely hold on to the
basketball. I'm not questioning whether or not he's injured, but most players at this stage of the playoffs have got some sort of bump
or
bruise, and they just have to play through it. I mean, that's what playoff legends do. You know, you hear about guys who have played through injuries, and he has to do it. He can't be sitting on the bench in the fourth quarter. I know it's a brave move by Dwayne Casey to go with the guys who are doing well, but he is an all-star. He's got to be out on the floor, and he's got to produce.
I'm interested to see tonight how Casey and the Raptors counter Eric Spoelstra's small ball lineup that they did at the end of Game 4. They went with, who did they go with? They went with Dragic, Wade, Winslow, Johnson, and Luol Deng really as their center at the end of Game 4. It finished the regulation on a nice +7 run there, obviously tied the game up. And then he stuck with that in the entire overtime frame, and it was also in +7, so +14 in the end. And Casey decided, yo, let's go, we'll go Patterson as our big. Mm. And Biombo did not get the minutes. I wonder if he says, well, screw that. we'll go big. We got the one true big in this, and we'll put Biombo out there, and we'll hide him on a player like Winslow, who they'd be probably happy to dare to shoot. This will be interesting to me.
I have no problem with Patterson out there. I have no problem with DeRozan sitting on the bench. You know, Dwayne Casey is praised when DeMar's sitting on the bench and they get a win. But now because they didn't perform and because they aren't performing all that well, we question it.
I question it because their three best lineups were when Biombo was in Game 4. And you saw as soon as he was out, it was Wade and Dragic and those guys attacking the rim because there's no Patterson, defense, he can't do that.
Game 3, though, the Raps closed with Joseph, Lowry, DeRozan, Carroll, and Patterson, and they did look good at the end of Game 3. Things were a little off in Game 4. I think that Casey's kind of got to be quick with the hook on DeRozan or Ross. Basically, whoever's hot, let him play. You need whichever one of them can actually score.
Well, maybe only play DeRozan because Lowry got fouled out too.
Well, that's why, from game to game, who the heck knows? That's the thing. It's who comes to play. And I think the Heat haven't been anywhere close to their ceiling. So you're more likely to get a version one day. One day they might have a good game.
We will see. All right, moving on to the Blazers-Warriors game. What do you guys think? Can the Blazers, does their season end tonight? Do they have any chance?
No, not really. I mean, you saw them lose. No, I mean, look, you want to try to be fair, but look, Steph's back and he had 40 off the bench the other night. Now he's got a game under his belt. They're at home. He was the MVP.
He's going to get the trophy
yesterday.
Probably in front of the crowd.
Yeah, there's going to be a lot of emotion in that building. Sometimes that can backfire, but I think the Warriors are too good and they know that the Western Conference Finals are right there for them.
What do you think?
That's a good answer.
I agree with
it. It's over.
I don't think it matters whether the Blazers, even if they win tonight, they're not going to win three in a row.
They've been great.
It's been a great season for Portland.
Oh, Game 4 really, really hurt them.
Yeah.
One more break when we come back. Lili's very solid play. Time for Lee's very solid play. Lili.
We're going to San Antonio. This might be the first time ever the Spurs have been in the very solid play, but not actually the ones executing the very solid play. It's the Oklahoma City Thunder. Gentle boomerang for Russell Westbrook there. He sets it up there. Some nice passing. Here it is again. It's a little bit slower than I normally like, but only one game on last night, so it didn't have a lot to choose from, but it's still beautiful. That's what I call a very solid play.
Good stuff, Lili. Two games on tonight, guys. Heat Raptors, 8 p.m. Eastern on TNT. Huge game. That series tied at 2 apiece. And Blazers-Warriors. Can the Warriors take care of business tonight? That one underway around 10:30 or so following the Heat Raptors game. We'll be back tomorrow night, break down those games and much, much more. 7 p.m. Eastern tomorrow night on NBA TV.
All right, looking forward to that. Thank you so much for joining us, folks. And remember, the moonwalk was created more than 30 years ago, and it should obviously stay there.
Race the night, people.